In this video lecture, I will discuss about an experiment by which one can measure the susceptibility. So, the aim of this experiment is defined by this way. The aim of the experiment is to measure the magnetic susceptibility of FeCl3 solution by Quincke's method. So this is the aim of this particular experiment, in which I have to measure the susceptibility. So first of all, after the aim of this experiment, and which is very clear that I have to measure the susceptibility, I will go detail in step by step that what is susceptibility and about the procedure of this experiment. So first of all, what are the apparatus are given here? This is electromagnet. These are basically coil. Electromagnet is this one, the central part of this. One pole becomes north and second becomes edge south. So alternating current power supply is given to this electromagnet, and the range of this the current which we provide to the electromagnet, this is electromagnet, and we are providing current to it by this power supply. This is our power supply. The range of the current is up to the 6 ampere. So we are providing current to this electromagnet up to the 6 ampere. The next, this is the power supply, right? And the next apparatus is Gauss meter, by which one can measure the magnetic field intensity which produced in the center of this electromagnet. So magnetic field strength we will measure at the center here. So that how much is the magnetic field intensity that we measure by this particular apparatus, and that is known as Gauss meter. So this switch you are looking here, this is 2K and there is 20K, here 20K is written. So that is the scale. If I keep this button in this way, it means it will measure up to the 2 kilo Gauss, the magnetic field intensity. But if I keep it in this way, it will measure up to the 20 kilo Gauss, the magnetic field intensity. And a probe is attached basically with it. This is a probe here, by which one can measure the magnetic field. So by this, by using this probe, one can measure the magnetic field. So these are major three components of this experiment. One is the Gauss meter, by which one can measure the magnetic flux intensity. Second is the power supply. This is power supply. We provide the current to this electromagnet. And the last one component and major important component is the Quincke's tube. So this is our Quincke's tube. This one is the Quincke's tube. This is of U shape, and sometimes it is called U-tube. And in this tube we have filled the FeCl3 solution. So these are major components of this experiment, and now I am switching on of this power supply for the electromagnet. So initially this is at zero. You can see here, and again the next point is about the Gauss meter. Switch on of it, and I'm making it at zero by this knob, and now this is almost at zero, so there is no magnetic field in surrounding of it. So I'm repeating again that through the Gauss meter one can measure the magnetic field intensity, right, in terms of the plugs, that is digital plugs basically. And this one is the power supply for the electromagnet, and at the end of it there is Twinks tube. This one is the U tube in which we have filled the FeCl3 solution, by which we will measure the susceptibility with the help of that. So now the first point is that here value of current is zero, so I am increasing it in steps. So at 1 ampere, so this is 1 ampere current is flowing in from the power supply to the electromagnet. And now I have to check the magnetic field intensity here. So right now I have handled this probe by hand, and there are some vibrations, so this is not fixed. And because of that, it might be magnetic field intensity vary. So you can see that right now magnetic field intensity is 3.63 kilo Gauss. So this is 3.6061 or 3.9. It varies because, as I told you, that my hand is not fixed here at the center between these two poles, and the distance varies, and because of that magnetic flux intensity changes. So now at the 1 ampere the magnetic field intensity is approximately 3.6 kilogauss. So now the second, again I am increasing the current at 2 ampere slowly. So now current is approximately at 2 ampere, and now again just measure the magnetic field intensity at the center. Between the two poles. So now you can see that is 6.50. Earlier it was 3.58, or right now it is coming approximately 6.5. So further, if I increase the current at 3 ampere, so now what will be the magnetic field intensity at the center? So now you can see that is 8.87 kilogauss. So now as you are increasing the current into the electromagnet, as a result magnetic field intensity is increasing. So you can calibrate also the magnetic field intensity in between these two poles. by doing this we you are providing current, and as a result of you are measuring the magnetic field intensity between the two poles. Now basically what we have to do, now again I'm keeping this power supply through this we are providing current to the electromagnet, so I'm making it at 0 ampere. So I made this at 0 and there is no any magnetic flux, magnetic field intensity near about that. So right now, or it will be better if I keep closed. Now I have to put the Quincke's tube in between these two poles. This is our electromagnet. This steel rod basically behaves like a magnet, and both surfaces are parallel, and because of that one can get uniform magnetic field in between these two poles. And intensity of the magnetic field varies according to the supply of the current. So now I am putting the Quincke's tube in between the two poles. But before I keep it in between the two poles, I want to show you that in this tube, this one is larger section, open section, there is no scale, and on the other hand in this side you can see that 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. This scale is made on the Quincke's tube, and through that one can measure the variation into this particular liquid if any, because of any reason it happens, right? So right now the initial position is approximately near to 2.9 or approximately 3. This is important point that we have to measure it exactly. So for that purpose I am keeping here at the center, I have kept it, and you can see all these things actually comes into the precautions. The height of the liquid or its depth when it decreases, we have to measure very carefully, and for that one can use the microscope. But right now I am not using microscope to measure that level. So roughly that is 2.9 centimeter. So I have noted down it, that without any magnetic field, no magnetic field, B is equal to 0, level is at 2.9 centimeter, right? So the point is, first point is that there is no magnetic field, B is 0, and level was at 2.9 centimeter. So now we apply current to this electromagnet and see the behavior of it, what happens. So at 1 ampere, switch on of it. Increase the current. Actually, I have put down this already before measuring the magnetic field intensity. So first of all, let me measure the magnetic field intensity in between the two poles, and that is 3.73. So at 1 ampere, the magnetic field intensity is 3.73 kilovolts. And now the height. Now I'm looking the height, how much it varies. We have to see that now very carefully. Let us see any change comes into this or not. So a very small change you can measure here. 1/2 of 1 millimeter. Right? So this is the this one. I have to measure this reading, and this I am writing down in the presence of 1 ampere current, it remains almost 2.9. With 0.5 millimeter plus minus, right? So now further I will increase the current by 1 ampere. So now I am increasing the current 1 ampere. So now you can see that current is of 2 ampere. Right? So now I have to check the strength of the magnetic field in between the poles. And that is 6.48. It is fluctuating, or it is, I am putting it 6.48 kilovolts. So at 2 ampere of the current, the magnetic field varies up to the 6.48, and now again I am inserting the Winck's tube in between the two poles, and now again check this scale, how much it varies. As you know that the base one is scale starts from here. This is 0, 1 and 2, and upper one is 3, and it is just below to the 3. How much? So now you can see it. It is approximately 2.8. So it is decreasing. This is 2.8 centimeter. The scale here you can see that is 2.8 centimeter. So I am using here two ways. One is that I am keeping this Quincke's tube in between the two poles and directly increasing the current. This time I will not measure the magnetic field. So I am directly increasing the current by 1 ampere. So current is now 3 ampere. And as a result, further, I have to see the height of the liquid. How much it varies? Now it comes up to the 2.7. If you see it here, so scale, as I told you earlier, starts from 0. This is 0, 1, 2, 2.5, 6, and 7. So now at this magnetic field intensity, it is 2.7. So at the same time, let us measure the magnetic field intensity here. It is vibrating because now this Quincke's tube has been attached somewhere with the magnetic poles. So the magnetic field intensity at this time is 8.80 kilovolts. So at 3 ampere, 8.80 kilovolts. And now further, I am increasing the current by 1 ampere. So now it reaches up to the 4 ampere. So at 4 ampere, the magnetic field intensity between the poles is approximately 'I have kept fixed it by hand, so I'm just trying to fix it at the center between the two poles, and it is 10.88. Right. So I am taking it as 10.88 kilovolts at 4 ampere. And now the height of the solution is same, or it will change? It will decrease further because now I have so if you see it carefully again on the scale, it is approximately 2.6. Right. So this is 2.6. So every time 1 millimeter is decreasing. And now at the end of the observation, I increasing the current by 1 ampere and now it becomes 5. So at 5 ampere, what will be the height of the solution in the Quincke tube? So it is approximately 2.4. Right, so this is 2.4. centimeter, and now again I have to measure the magnetic field at the same current, that was 5 and at this particular current the magnetic field intensity is about 12.73, right? So I am taking it 12.74. So this was the magnetic field intensity. This is 12.74 kilo goes at 5 ampere. So in this observation you have seen, and now I am keeping close it. So in this experiment you have seen that the initial point these are some observations, right, taken by us right now. So initial point I have circled, that was 2.9 centimeter. In the absence of magnetic field, then B was equal to 0. So magnetic field intensity was 0 there. And now I am increasing the current by 1 ampere. So it remain almost same. At 1 ampere, the magnetic field intensity which I observed, that was 3.73 kilovolts. At 2 ampere, it was 6.48 kilovolts, and the height remained 2.8 centimeter. So it decreases by 1 millimeter. And again, at 3 ampere of the current, magnetic field intensity is increasing, and the height level of the solution is decreasing by 1 millimeter. This is 2.7 centimeter. At 4 ampere, the magnetic field intensity was 10.88 kilovolts, and the level basically comes at 2.6 centimeter. At 5 ampere, the magnetic field intensity was 12.74 kilovolts, and now the level is at 2.4 centimeter. So if you see all these data carefully, there are only two things in this experiment. One is the magnetic field intensity, and second is the height of the level. So here in this particular experiment, the level basically decreases. The reason of it, because a main part of the Quincke tube was in between the two poles. So right now if you see it, so this is outside from the magnet, and only the bigger part was inside to the electromagnet, and because of that level of the solution decreases. Now for the susceptibility, what we have to do and what is susceptibility. After this observation, where we measure only the current, magnetic field intensity and the levels, height of in Quincke's tube of the FeCl3 solution. Now the first question is, why the level of liquid in Quincke's tube rises or falls? What is the reason behind of that? When you keep any solution in the presence of external magnetic field, you have seen here that level was decreasing every time when you were increasing the intensity of the external magnetic field. So I will try to find out the answer of this question along with the that what is the susceptibility and how one can find out that susceptibility by using a particular formula which is derived from this observations. So we know that susceptibility is associated with the permeability. We know that B is equal to mu naught H in free space, right? So I can show you that B is equal to mu naught H. We know about it. B is equal to mu naught H. What is B and what is H? We have to discuss about it in a particular section where we have to explain the susceptibility. But before that, B is magnetic field density and H is the magnetic field intensity. B is the magnetic field density and H is the magnetic field intensity. So the first point related to the observation of this experiment and how one can basically which formula that is suitable to measure the susceptibility. So in this observation, if you see it carefully, so here in this picture I have made, this is the Quincke's tube and these are the magnet, electromagnet, permanent magnets basically. This is north pole, this is south pole, and in between you have keep this solution, and this basically shows the level of the inside the Quincke's tube. This is at some particular height and this is below at this particular level. And this particular level basically indicate to that when there was no magnetic field. But when you apply the magnetic field, so what happens? It can rise up or it can fall down. So you can see here in this particular picture, the level basically rises up. And on the other hand, it will decrease from the this horizontal line. That was the level in the absence of magnetic field. Here I have shown that magnetic field direction is along the Z, and this is Z axis, and this perpendicular direction is X direction. So magnetic field is applied along the Z direction and level rising or fall along the X direction. So it means the force will exerted on the liquid along the X direction. Right? I have cleared my point in for this particular explanation, that force exerted along the X direction. Magnetic field is along the z direction. So that component will be your bz. And if I have to select component of the force, that will be along the x direction, that means fx. So you have seen that many times this equation mu r is equal to 1 plus chi in magnetic materials chapter, where b is equal to mu naught h, and chi we define with the ratio of intensity of magnetization to the external magnetic field intensity. So I will discuss all these components into the next section of this video lecture. But before that, from where we have derived the formula to measure the magnetic susceptibility of any material, that is the point. So chi is equal to m upon h, where m is the intensity of magnetization in the field and h is the external field. So m you can write chi into h. Chi we have defined already in terms of mu r, so that value of chi is equal to mu r minus 1, and h is equal to b upon mu naught. So you can write this m is equal to, this m is equal to chi b upon mu naught. This is our equation number 1. So we have derived this equation from this result. And now the important point and major point about the force. The force on a magnetic dipole, force on a magnetic dipole of moment m due to an applied magnetic field B is F x m is equal to mx dbx upon dx plus my dby upon dy plus mz dbz upon dz. So what basically I am doing here, I am just trying to find out the force component which is exerted on the solution in Quincke's tube, and this force basically explained on the basis of magnetic dipole. So force on a magnetic dipole of moment m, moment of the magnetic dipole moment moment of the magnetic dipole is m, and due to an applied external magnetic field, m is the moment of magnetic dipole. Now we apply the external magnetic field, so the force on the magnetic dipole along the x direction, so x indicate to the direction, m indicate to the moment, right, moment of this magnetic dipole. So the force on it will be in terms of these component, x component, y component, z component, and this is my equation number 2. So if you want to know more about this force on the magnetic dipole, so you can read this paper of Timoth H. Boyer in American Journal of Physics in the year of 1988. So in that paper basically it is discussed that how much force apply on the magnetic dipole, right? So from there one can find out the idea of it. So the force per unit volume experienced at a point in the liquid in the U tube is given by force per unit volume. Force is applying along the x direction, and this is U, volume, It means per unit volume. The force per unit volume will be equal to chi bz mu naught into dbz upon dx. So I just put the value of mx. This m is equal to, as you have seen earlier, m is equal to chi b upon mu naught. So I am putting the value of m, that is chi bz mu naught, because magnetic field is along the z direction. So I will consider which component of b, that is along the z direction. So this force per unit volume will be equal to chi beta z upon mu naught into dbz upon dx. dbz upon dx. So magnetic field component will be along the z direction and force is applying along the x direction. So force per unit volume is equal to chi beta z upon mu naught dbz upon dx. So this is the basic idea of the force which is exerted on the liquid at the magnetic dipole. So I have to explain that why the level of liquid rises up and fall down, that is because of this force. So in the Quincke's tube, I have to explain this idea on the basis of this force.